And now a little story from the Appleseed.
Thank you very much. I grew up on a hill called Weberwood Hill in some of my stories. And Weberwood Hill was about a mile from the top of Weberwood Hill to the bottom of Weberwood Hill. And the first third of the hill was almost straight up and down. And then it sort of flattened out a little bit at Claret Circle. And then the top part of the hill was maybe even more straight up and down than the bottom third of the hill. And at the bottom of the hill, there was a curve that when I was a child, we would have called, well, we did call, Dead Man's Curve. But now we know that children are much too sensitive for that sort of language. So now we would call it something like Wicked Timeout Curve. And if you missed that curve, you went off the road and there were about 10 trees and then a cliff that was about 14,000 feet. And at the bottom of that cliff, there was a pool of inky black liquid. And our parents told us never to touch that liquid. They said if we touched that liquid, that it was so polluted that it would eat the flesh off of our bodies. And then they told us to never go swimming in it, because if we went swimming in it, we would wake the mer creatures, the mermaids and mermen that lived at the bottom, and they would swim to the surface and eat the flesh off of our body. We thought, how can they eat the flesh off of our bodies if the liquid has already burned it off? But we just wrote it off as the stupid sort of thing that adults say. And so anyway, we were sitting at the top of Weberwood Hill. We were on our bicycles. We were getting ready to ride our bicycles down Weberwood Hill. And the goal was to pedal the entire way down, to be in 10th gear by the time you got to my house, the fourth house down the hill, and to never touch your brakes all the way down. And the reason we wanted to do this is because we thought if we pedaled hard enough, we could build up enough friction on our sprockets that we could set our chains on fire. And the reason we thought we could set our chains on fire is because Nora said we could. Now, Nora was a girl in our neighborhood. She was the smartest girl in the neighborhood. She was the funniest girl in the neighborhood. She was the prettiest girl in the neighborhood. And we were right at that age where boys start to think to themselves, well, if girls have cooties, maybe cooties aren't such a bad thing to have. So when Nora said stuff like, if you pedal hard enough, you can set your chains on fire, all the boys in the neighborhood were like, uh-huh, Nora, you're pretty. We'll do it. Which is not something boys outgrow. And so there we were, getting ready to ride our bikes down the hill. And now, to be totally honest, I didn't want to set my chain on fire. I just wanted to know the kid who set his chain on fire. Because when I was growing up, whenever I was about to do something stupid, my dad would run in the room and he'd be like, no, 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 never try and cut glass with scissors. Dan Carlisle tried to cut glass with scissors. The glass broke. He cut his hand off. He was never the same afterwards. Our dad would say, no, 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 never tie your sled to a moving car. Dan Carlisle tied his sled to a moving car. The car stopped. Dan didn't. He hit his head. He was never the same afterwards. Her dad would say, no, 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 never put a slug in your ear. Dan Carlisle put a slug in his ear, ate his brain. He was never the same afterwards. Now, I can never follow the chronology of poor Dan's life, but I know he was never the same afterwards. So I didn't want to set my chain on fire. I just wanted to know the kid who set his chain on fire. And my chief candidate was a guy named Elmore Lofink. Now, here's what you have to know about Elmore. Elmore played T-ball for 2 years. You understand T-ball, right? There's a stand. It's maybe 2.5 feet tall, little piece of rubber on top. You put the baseball on top of that, and then you come up and you swing. The ball is not moving. It's not going 100 miles an hour. It's not sliding. It's not corkscrewing. It's not curving. It's just sitting there. 2 years, Elmore played T-ball. Never got a hit. He went over the ball. The little rubber thing under the ball, he sent that over the second baseman's head on several occasions, but the ball just went thunk. And I have to say that when I took my children to play T-ball, you know, the coach was there, and the coach was like, okay, there's no outs. Everybody gets to hit, and we don't keep score. And I said to my children, when I played T-ball, there were 3 outs. Not everybody got to hit. And if you made it to first base and then second base and then third base and then home, we called that a run, and somebody made a mark in a book. And at the end of the game, we counted up those marks, and the team that had the most runs, we called them the winner. And I said to my children, remember, if nobody wins, Everybody's a loser. But anyway, Elmore had graduated from the baseball arts and had gone into the bicycling arts. And Elmore was set on setting his chain on fire. Of all the kids in the neighborhood who wanted to set his chain on fire, Elmore most wanted to set his chain on fire. Because of all the kids in the neighborhood that had a crush on Nora, Elmore had the biggest crush on Nora. Elmore wanted to date Nora. He wanted to serenade Nora. He wanted to write her love poems like, "Nora, Nora, how I adore ya." You throw a little scat in there, that'll really swing, man. You know, he wanted to marry Nora, have 1,000 children with Nora, and live the rest of his life with Nora. And Nora did not feel the same way about Elmore. Nora thought if she had to spend the rest of her life with Elmore, maybe they could be neighbors if there were a couple of houses in between. But Elmore was sure that if he could set his chain on fire, he could win Nora's heart. So Nora said, "Go," and we started off down the hill. Now, young people, this is going to shock you, but we were not wearing safety gear. When I was a kid, only 4 kinds of people wore safety gear: firemen, construction workers, professional football players, and astronauts. If your job did not include running into a burning building, having an I-beam dropped on your head, purposely running into another human being, or re-entering the atmosphere, if you wore safety gear, you were sort of a wimp, and that's all there was to it. Plus, we didn't need safety gear because we had something kids don't have now. We had something called tough skin blue jeans. Tough skin blue jeans were made by the Sears Roebuck Corporation. They were made from DuPont Tribond 490 polyester. They had reinforced knees. The sales slogan was, "Your children will outgrow them before they wear them out." You couldn't bend your knees when you were wearing a pair of tough skins. Everybody walked around the neighborhood like they had just peed their pants. And they were bulletproof. You could be going down the highway at 80 miles an hour, 6 kids in the back of a pickup truck. Your dad hits a bump, 1 kid goes flying out, hits the asphalt. That child would be fine. They would just slide down the highway. So long as they just kept from their waist to their ankles on the highway, they would be fine. The only thing that could go wrong is if you had one of these little metal rivets and sparks started to come out. If you were beside a tanker truck that was leaking, kaboom. Well, you would be fine. No. That's not true. You wouldn't be fine. You would be gone from the waist up and the ankles down. But anything covered by your tough skins would be fine. And so, anyway, I was putting my daughter on that little seat on the back of my bicycle one time when she was little. So I put her helmet on and her elbow pads and her knee pads and her shin guards and her little gloves and her Kevlar vest. And I put her on the seat, and I was getting on the seat myself, and I went to swing my leg over and bam, I kicked her right in the face. The only part of her body I could have hurt her. Not on purpose, you understand. And that didn't really happen to me. I read that in Reader's Digest, but I thought it was funny. And so I stole it. And that, children, is how you cite a source. So we were going down the hill, pedaling as fast as we could. I was in 10th gear. Elmore was right beside me. He was in 10th gear. Already other kids were chickening out. We were pedaling as hard as we could, and I was trying to remember front brake, back brake, front brake, back brake. Because if you're going down a hill like this and you hit your front brake, you're just going to cartwheel. And I was looking for dogs. I'll tell you why I was looking for dogs. Because my dad told me that the bicycle tires on those bikes were so thin that if you hit a dog. Now, here's the thing, again, for the young people. You've probably in your life had an adult say something to you where you thought to yourself, "I know that adult is trying to communicate useful information to me, but what that adult just said is the single most moronic thing I have ever heard in my life." And I'll tell you what happens. We used to be smart. We used to be young, and then we grew up. We didn't mean to. It just happens. And so we'll be standing there, and we'll get an idea. It'll kind of bloom in our head like a tulip, and it'll be like, "I am a good idea. Find a young person. Share me with a young person." So we go, and we find a young person, and the idea's up there, and it's like, "Good idea, good idea." And it comes through our head and out our mouth, "Good idea." And it gets halfway between our mouth and your ears, and it looks back at us, and it goes, "Dumb, dumb, dumb." So my dad said to me, "You have to watch out on those bicycles because those tires are so thin that if you hit a dog, you will cut the dog in half." And I know my dad meant, be careful. don't hit a dog. But as soon as he said that, all I could think was, I want to hit a dog. And it's not that I don't love dogs, you know, maybe it could be like a rabid dog, like an Atticus Fitch sort of thing, you know, read a book. And Dad meant if you hit a dog in the side, you'd cut it in half. I wanted to hit a dog in the nose, just see if I could split it right down the middle. So, going down the hill, pedaling as fast as we could. Now, Nora was a little bit behind us. Nora couldn't set her chain on fire because when Nora was born, we never knew why, but her legs had never worked. She'd been in a wheelchair her entire life, but she was the kind of kid that when she said to her parents, I am going to ride my wheelchair down the hill, they did not say, oh gosh, Nora, I think that would be a bad idea. Because they'd known her whole life, and they knew she was going to do it anyway. So they said things like, oh gosh, we better take a welding class. And so they had welded her this wheelchair out of steel pipes. It was like the inside of a NASCAR race car. It had a steering wheel and a seat with a 27-point harness system. It had big, fat off-road tires. It had a plexiglass windshield, nets on the side. It had a handbrake. And because she couldn't set her chain on fire, she just had lengths of chain hanging out from behind her wheelchair that would slap into the ground, and great plumes of sparks would come up. So we're going down the hill. We got to Claire's Circle, where everything sort of flattened out, and more kids are chickening out, till we get to the top of the last part of the hill, and it was just myself and Elmore left side by side. Nora was a little bit behind us, and I could smell hot metal, like when you're standing next to an old radiator or a car that's just been turned off. And I looked down to see if my chain was on fire. My sprocket wasn't even red, but I could still smell hot metal. So I looked over at Elmore's bicycle, and his sprocket was glowing bright red, and there were heat waves shimmering off of it, bouncing off his tough skins, going up into the sky, burning a hole in the ozone layer. And then, whoosh, 80 feet of flame shot out from behind Elmore's bicycle. And he was so excited, he was screaming, I'm on fire! I'm on fire! And he turned and he said, Nora, I'm on fire for you! And the symbolism was lost on us. But there it was. We'd done it. We'd set our chains on fire. Notice how I take credit. And so I started to brake. And I was back brake, front brake. And Elmore was back brake, front brake. And then Nora shot in between us, going 704 miles an hour. Something had gone wrong with her brakes. She couldn't stop. There was no way she was going to make it around wicked timeout curve. She was going to go off the road, through the trees, into the pool. I didn't want that to happen, but I didn't know what to do. And then Elmore did the bravest thing I've ever seen. He let go of his brakes and he started to pedal as hard as I could. And I wanted to know what was going to happen. So I let go of my brakes and I started to pedal as hard as I could. And Elmore, just before Nora, when all that separated Nora from certain doom was the thin white line on the edge of the road, Elmore whipped in front of her on his bicycle, and he grabbed his front brake as hard as he could. He stood his bicycle up on its front wheel, wiggled his hips, spun his bicycle around in a great 360-degree arc, and his back tire hit the front of Nora's wheelchair and sent it rolling back up the hill. Here was a child who could not hit a baseball. Sitting stationary in front of him on a windless afternoon, who had just rotated his burning bicycle to knock a wheelchair up the hill. And I jumped off my bicycle and grabbed the back of Nora's wheelchair and kind of ran it to a stop. And Elmore jumped off his bicycle, and we stood there watching Elmore's bicycle just melt into the road. We were breathing the sweet asphalt fumes. Which I think goes on to explain a few things. And when it was all gone, when there was nothing left but some aluminum ash and some bubbles in the asphalt, when it was all gone, Nora turned to Elmore, and she said to Elmore in that voice that only girls can use, and I caution young women who are just discovering this voice, please use it for the powers of good. Because it is a voice that girls can use, females can use, that can make boys do anything. And Nora looked at Elmore, and she had a twinkle in her eye, and she said, in that tone of voice, she said, Elmore, you can push me back up the hill. Thank you very much.
Thanks for joining us for a little story from the Appleseed.